that she went pretty well armed. We sat there talking about the lobster tank.
1993.
And with them chicken fried steaks, her arms.
Chicken fried steak.
Cracker Barrel is what I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, it's good.
And the redwood deck.
Now, up here on the right is my parents' house. This is where I grew up. We're going to circle back to them after we see June. But yeah, so another thing about the clans. My cousin lives here. My parents live here. My grandmother lives here.
Oh, wow. It's,
and, yeah.
It's like a homestead.
And the sister lives
here.
Uh-huh.
So.
Hi, Mamaw Gracie.
Mamaw Grice. Yeah, it's my sisters and my niece and nephew up there. Mm-hmm. And another thing that's interesting is there is a little bit. So other than myself and my aunt that I mentioned, Betty Reynolds, the tambourine owner, she and I are the two who don't live here on the creek still. And there's a little bit of judgment about that. It's low key. But there is definitely a certain amount of judgment that we left.
It's low key at all.
I think if you never come around, she's here every week.
Yeah.
She's here every week.
But
she never comes around. What?
Yes, but there's a little bit of judgment about the fact that I left, right? So it's kind of like, if you look at Appalachian literature and like just in general, that's a recurring theme, is that there's this desire to leave and see what else is out there. And most of the time, when a person does leave, they wind up coming back at some point. So there's always like this, it's sort of like an oxymoron, you know, because you want to leave. You want to leave the mountains. You want to leave your home and see what else is out there. And on the same note, you're always homesick, you know.
Hmm. And then there's a Confederate flag.
Yeah. And then there's that.
So I'm Caitlin Yarbrough, and I was actually born in High Point, North Carolina, and grew up in Savannah, Georgia. And then we relocated to Johnson City right before my freshman year of high school. And we moved here so my dad could go to Emanuel School of Religion, because my dad is an ordained minister. So I went to UTC for literally one semester, got a job at Mellow Mushroom, hospitality industry, and fell in love like instantaneously. Stopped going to class. I failed tennis. It was bad. I was a bad student. Getting into the hospitality industry, made friends, started training. I was a hostess and a busser, and then like wanted to know everything. And so I climbed the ladder there. That's where I first learned about hospitality, which right now I'm an innkeeper and am now a baker, which I don't know where that came from, but I'm opening a bakery. And it's just weird how things happen. Because Blake and I are conscious about the world today and society as it is, he was totally cool with me owning the business, being a black female business owner.
In the South.
Deep South. On Main Street in right. Tennessee's oldest town. And he was completely A-okay with it. And what's funny is that, let's see, that was in July of 2018 that I took over ownership of the business. And so it's 2021, and literally like a few months ago, or actually it was back in February, he had a family member say something about, are you not proud as a white man to be, aren't you an owner? You're a white man, you should be proud as well, because it was, you know, Black History Month, highlighting me. And I was really proud of him because he was just like, I literally am white. Like, I get accolades every day. I don't even have to do anything except just get up. And he was just like, you know, my wife worked really hard and I hate to say the term, like, pulled herself up by her bootstraps, but I put in the work. If there's a ladder, I would climb. And so, you know, it was just really nice and reassuring that the person I've chosen to spend my life with is going to back me up, being a minority and doing this stuff. I told you. This is Nico. This is our child. Is he scratching himself? Oh, he's not bleeding. Oh my gosh, buddy. He's going to the vet on Tuesday. You getting the cone of shame. Well, this is our child. He's black and white. And brindle. And furry. Well, I don't think that it's the people that need to be better. I think it's the system as a whole. One, it's not broken. It's working how it's supposed to. Like, they want to keep people oppressed. They want to keep you stupid. So, like, there are people just down the road, you know, once you get out of, like, Jonesboro proper, that don't have internet. They don't have cable TV. Like, there is no exposure to anything else. And so keeping people in this box, which is what it feels like living in East Tennessee. It's just very interesting that there's no exploration of other cultures or even the curiosity of, like, something different. They're just very complacent. So if I would say that they needed to work on something, the people in this area as a whole, it's like, don't be complacent, which is kind of, you know, some people just wanna sit on their porch and do their job 9 to 5 and come home and do nothing. And so, like, no shade to those people, but I'm just not that. I've got to be doing something constantly. So that's just kind of baffling to me, is just how comfortable people are being as ignorant as they are. Some of it's willful, some of it is just due to their situation, the socioeconomic status of, you know, the majority.
Yeah, like a system of poverty.
Yeah.
It just gets passed down generation to generation to generation. And
then, yeah,
it becomes like an insulated bubble.
Right.
And, yeah.
And it's hard to pop it. And so, and you'll see that with anybody that's in power, like local elected officials, they're all super wealthy, because they all have vested interest in everything that's going on. And if you have money, that equates to power in most people's minds. I see money and think corruption instantly. Like, my brain is just trained for that now. So if I see, I'm a practicing minimalist. So I'm, like, always purging and getting rid of stuff. Unless it's weird Grinch things, because I'm obsessed. But yeah, just trying to get people to realize that, like, the genuine struggle of just waking up and getting yourself together, getting your family ready, getting everybody out the door, working your job, and then coming home doesn't mean that you still can't serve your community, even if it's just being a representative for people that are just like you. So we have all of these representatives who have no idea what it's like to be us. You know, I get up at 4:30 in the morning and, like, get all my baking stuff done. Then I make breakfast for our guests. And then I, you know, take care of myself and my dog and eat lunch if I can. And, you know, and it just doesn't stop. And so for these people that are making the system work, or are putting, you know, our 2 cents in from this region, they really truly aren't. They vote in opposition of things that would help. And, you know, just that goes back to that whole open your eyes and complacency and exposure thing. It's just people aren't paying attention to see that, like, these people that they're rooting for nonstop are doing absolutely nothing for you. And in fact, they, like, have their foot on your head and are holding you down in this subservient position.
This, yeah, is hardcore conservative, and conservative in the fact of, they don't want to change. They enjoy the way life is right now, and so they're very afraid of...
But the majority of them don't even realize that it could be so much better. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ignorance.
Yeah. And it's like...
Which is not an insult. It's just not knowing better.
Would you consider yourself a bitter Southerner?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I'm very bitter. If I could pick up, if I could click drag the in out of here,
oh, yeah.
We'd be gone tonight. We would be out of here. gone.
In my father's house, we never had guns. I've never had a gun.
Until the protests last summer.
Not until the protests and some weird, sketchy people.
Get some threats.
Did I buy my first gun? I hate that, too. Because I'm not a big fan of guns. But I understand with she and I being where we live.
And big mouths.
Having people in the hotel who we don't know who they are. For a measly $200, you easily could buy a room and come in here and kill us.
Yeah, because we live here.
Yeah.
Do you think being an interracial couple, kind of fuels some of that?
We get looks
more
all
the
time. I think.
But we're too confident with ourselves now.
Yeah.
You know, in the beginning, we would notice it.
Yeah.
I don't know if it happens.
Like, now I know people stare all the time, but I just, I'm so over them that I don't even, look up. I'm in my own world. I really, truly don't care. Keep staring.
And?
Please.
We're powerful. Powerful couple.
Yeah. I think people now,
easily can walk down the street and shake hands and have a good conversation with every mayor that's been in our county, cities, past, present.
Not that we agree with them, but...
Our voice matters, which is nice.
But we're still cordial and friendly.
Yeah.
Well, because we all love our community. I will say I do think that they love the community. They love their parts of the community, we'll say that. But I think that that's some common ground where you can, be able to, I can't cuss, can I? Sorry.
Okay.
Where you can, shoot the shit with somebody that you totally just can't stand.
Yeah.
You can't stand them, can't stand what they stand for, but you can...
I can find the middle ground.
You can talk about Jonesboro or talk about UT or whatever.
Yeah.
The weather. Annoying. Not right, Nico.
So, you love this place and you hate this place?
Yes. If we could...
It was more progressive. I mean, I've not been into really deep south states like Alabama, Mississippi. We drove through them.
Not stopping. No, thank you.
The amount of rebel flags and stuff in Johnson City and Jonesboro, it was just ridiculous.
It rivals South Carolina's rebel flag situation. We don't have them on the side of the highways like they do down there, because I hate that.
Tennessee is racist as hell. I know they had a KKK meeting somewhere in public, a rally.
Where?
In Tennessee on Saturday.
Here, around here?
No, I think it was more towards middle to west.
I'm trying to dress up like Clayton Bixby.
yeah. It is real and alive in our area. So you just got to be careful.
It's true.
And then, they don't like us because we are a mixed couple.
It's true.
But that's okay. Andrew's going to hate.
All day. Day. But yeah. It's a beautiful area. But, moving from Savannah, Georgia to here sucked at the time. And now... that I'm older, Savannah is super touristy. Time's gone by enough that it's Gatlinburg down there on River Street. So, I don't want to be there either. So, this is home. But, I guess we're at the point where we don't mind to criticize this area. Because if you don't criticize something, it's not going to get better. If you can't acknowledge the aspects of something that's not good, then you're not going to be... you do it with paper.
Well, that's like...
Papers,
say,
proofread. Write it again.
It's not
no. We're the worst.
We're not the worst.
We're up there with controlling the worst.
Definitely third world country style.
Has anybody watched...
The simpleness of healthcare.
Oliver Stone's Real American History on Netflix.
That's a good one.
You need to watch it.
A lot of real...
Yeah. Oliver Stone, the director, he did... He follows... Who does he start with? Does he start with World War II?
Probably starts with World War I.
Yeah, I think he starts with World War I, but it goes all the way up, and it ends... The last episode is, the beginning of Obama, but he's got stuff on him, too, of just, don't be fooled, blah, blah, blah. But it's
really?
It's not... Yeah, it's very educational, and it's not,
We just live here.
propaganda crazy stuff. It's just facts of like, you didn't know that we started this war because on the side this was going on.
Oh, yeah, like da 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 da. We made things happen so that we could get to that war.
Yeah. You just don't realize, unless you want to, that stuff's just, it's not as good. Nothing is as good as it seems, unless.
Unless you're powerful.
Yeah.
Or unless you just.
Or unless you make it so.
Yeah.
But it's always a struggle.
I mean, we're very happy and we live well. Because I just wish for those that are not as fortunate, you know, that things can be better.
What do you think people here are afraid of?
Change.
Yeah, change. And they would tell you, like, commies, socialism, and it's like,
CRT.
That would all help you. Yeah, critical race theory, which is
they're afraid law. Of America, hating America.
They're afraid of the criticisms and the truth of, like, this is how bad it was. You get around here the people that are like, well, the slaves, you know, they were taken care of. So what do you want to say?
Didn't get reparations.
Yeah, because they had property taken from them, so it's just like, cool.
Yeah.
We got y'all backwards folks. So, yeah, I think they're just afraid of looking inward and actually, you know, committing to making whatever change is necessary because they are comfortable and they don't want to change.
One generation ago, people were like, "That's so long ago."
No, it's not.
You won't even let them teach about Jim Crow.
You peel back the paint, and it's going to say whites only.
Yeah.
You
know? Well, we have a door. This door outside.
Can you show us?
Yeah. It's. I need to trim the weeds down, but so this was all redone in 2000, like between 1997 and 2000. But they did have a back porch, but this place was really dilapidated. But they did serve breakfast and lunch and supper, and they would not let black people come inside to order or to eat. They could eat on the back porch, and this was the colored entrance. And Dr. Kennedy kept it when they redid the inn because he's a firm believer in historic preservation, but also like letting the property and the buildings tell their story, and so that there is no, you know, you can't lie about this door. I mean, you could. I could tell people it's whatever, but I call it Door to Nowhere. I also think it's hilarious because now a black girl owns it. And so it's just like, I want to paint it a different color and get a plaque so that people know, but I almost want like a colored only thing just so that people can see how offensive it is. But then I do also worry about the backlash of like people not reading the full plaque of like the history of the door and being like, there's some black racist girl down there in Jonesboro with a colored only door. So yeah, I'm not sure what to do. It's nice that we get to be ambassadors to people that come and visit the area. So if people do come and stay here, they get to meet us first. And stay with us and get to know us instead of like being at the Country Inn and Suites or somewhere where they're not going to have like a personal conversation with somebody, not necessarily.
Yeah, I sat with our guests last night. All six of them played card games with them last night.
Yeah.
Tell them our story and all that fun stuff. So.
It's nice to be able to put our face and our stamp of this is what Jonesboro is. This is where you should go. You know, we can steer them away from stereotypes and dumb stuff.
Well, and, you know, the reality is there are a lot of black families that are afraid to travel to certain areas.
Yeah,
and
I really
so
want the green book to come back.
That'd
be nice.
Hey, you know, it is safe to come here.
That's so in all of our almost 7 years, or it has been 7 years, 7 years of being here in keeping?
Yeah.
How many black people have we had stay here?
Less than a handful.
Yeah, like literally less than 10.
In 7 years. No, less than a handful.
And that's, and anytime I see someone black on Main Street, I'm always like, I don't try to like run up to them and be like, welcome. Yeah. Hey, what are you doing here? No, I don't do that. But I just try to make sure that if they lock eyes with me, then I'm like, smiling and inviting, and if you need me to take your photo, I'm happy to do that, because we literally saw a black couple cross the street to get away from like this horde of what looked like, you know,
Karens,
redneckeries.
Yeah. And that sucks, because you know, I've never ever had to think about that ever. As like, hey, is this an okay place to, you know, to go to?
Yeah. Well, you do now, because I don't go just everywhere.
Sure.
I make him go in and check stuff out. But he's my scout.
Sure. Yeah.
But if
yeah.
you were not.
If I wasn't okay, yeah, that wouldn't be ever an issue.
Yeah. That's like that place in Gatlinburg. It's got that rebel. We didn't know until we sat down, but it has like a big rebel flag on the ceiling, that bar.
We're inquisitive and adventurous, and so, you know, we go different places, but then we learn real quick.
Yeah, real quick.
Will you go into businesses or places and you'll stay outside, or
no.
What was that?
You were saying, go check out. Oh, I'll have him like go scout something out if I need him to. So like the Tipsy Toad, when that first opened, I was like, this is not my
scene.
And then we went and it was like packed, and I was like, just go in there and see what the vibe is.
There was a black dude in there.
There was one black dude. He was like, there's one black dude. Bring your crossword puzzle. You'll be okay. I was like, okay, cool. Because,
yeah.
I mean, I do. I'll bring something just
but
to
black
not.
Not black.
No, he wasn't. He was just very.
I mean, he was black, but.
He was. He's born and raised here and is one of the guys. But, I'll bring something literally just so that I don't have to, like, avert my eyes of people, like, staring.
Yeah.
It's annoying.
At you or you? As a couple.
Both.
Yeah.
I'm pretty.
Well, then they, you know, and then they, I'm assuming they assume stuff about me. Oh, liberal ass over there.
They'd be right.
Hi.
Hello. Yeah, it's interesting.
It's like, I might be liberal, but I still enjoy the same things that you all enjoy.
Yeah,
I like shooting guns. I got a dog. I love UT.
You like to be
beers,
outside.
Bourbon.
I can probably milk a goat faster than you.
Yeah.
Suck it, Whoville. That we will.
Have you ever been to Jellicoe at all? Okay.
I've been around this area, but I've never been.
To Jellicoe, right. Well, the school is it's interesting because it's basically like the community hub. The town, and this is not to speak ill of the town, because I love this area and I want to be in this area. Like, it's purposeful. I'm here by choice. but it's very much like lots of Appalachian places. It's completely ravaged by the opioid epidemic. And as a matter of fact, full disclosure, Ashley's sister just died of an overdose, like in October. Yeah.
Like last month.
We have taken her daughter as a foster for now. She's not here today. She's with her grandmother, but it's the opioid epidemic has absolutely just ravaged these small towns. Jellicoe is no exception. So it's sort of a dying coal town.
Jellicoe.
Mm-hmm. It was at one point a booming coal town, but of course coal it's not what it was, you know, and that's not a bad thing, but because of that, the town is essentially dying, and the people there, really all there is the school. There's the school and basically two restaurants in Jellicoe.
So we are our county. Because of our status in terms of poverty and high poverty, we all students eat breakfast and lunch for free. So, you know, back in the day, people had to pay. Now they don't. So in the mornings, the majority of our kids don't come to school having eaten breakfast. Some of them do, of course. But the cafeteria sends up, they serve a hot breakfast in the cafeteria until 7:40. And then at 7:40, we do have one late bus that doesn't get here till about almost 8, usually. And those kids have to go straight to class, because as an elementary school status, we start class at 7:45. Right, we're going. We're rolling.
Oh, okay.
So I am the person standing up front with usually the hot bag of like a biscuit or whatever, you know. And they grab it and they go.
the school brings people out and is poor. And this is my house I'm renting in the middle of a pasture field, as you can see. because of that, it's fascinating because you think, Jellicoe is a very poor place. There's not a lot of money in Jellicoe. But if anything, like fundraising for the school, for example, people will come out and whatever pennies that they have, they'll give it to the school because it's the hub, you know, it's the community center, essentially. And let me tell Ashley I'm here so she can put the dogs up. We are here. All right. And this area is called Elk Valley, aka specifically right here is Terry Creek. There's a creek just across the road, and we can walk over if y'all want to.
Yeah, sure.
Terry Creek. Oh, there's Benny and Stella. Hey. so far I'm really loving it. This mountain here in front of us is Pioneer Mountain, and Stinking Creek, where I grew up, is just on the other side of this, actually. Okay. So it's kind of, it's like being back home, but not being back home.
Right. You're divided by the mountain.
Divided by the mountain. Exactly. I'm going to write about that, actually. It's on my list of things to write about, but yeah. They're not accepting.
Still.
Ashley is still not welcome. Like Thanksgiving is coming up, for example. And I also feel like I have a work to do there because I have a niece and a nephew. They're 7 and 4. My sister's children, and they're being raised the same way that I was raised. And this is not any kind of negativity about the Pentecostal church at all or evangelicals at all.
And your parents are Pentecostal.
They're Pentecostal. I grew up in the Church of God. I was signed, sealed, delivered, believed it until I fell in love with a woman, and then I was like, oh no, I've really got to rethink all this. Like, oh no, whoa. Now what? You know.
Slipped on a big banana.
Yeah, what do I do now?
So.
Yeah. And I love them and I respect them, and in many, many ways, they are wonderful human beings. But they cannot. It's a religious thing. And at the end of the day, I always struggle with this. Ashley and I have talked about this a lot. At the end of the day, I can't really be angry with them. I am, but I can't justify it fully because I know that their non-acceptance comes from a place of love, as messed up as that sounds, because they genuinely believe that I'm going to hell. They genuinely believe that my eternal soul is bound for hell. Because I'm in a relationship with a woman.
Forever.
And I know that that's the base of it. And so I find that it's very hard to maneuver because I want to be angry with them. And I want to say, like my sister, for example, she's married to a man with 2 wonderful children. But like on holidays, they're very much accepted and very much validated. And Ashley is not welcome.
Are you welcome to be physically present?
Nope. Still, and
no.
Mm-hmm. No. And that's the thing. So like, it's very hard to maneuver because in a way for me to go around them is for me to deny myself and to deny the validity of our relationship. And I sometimes feel like that's not the right thing to do because I feel like it also, invalidates Ashley, and our relationship. But at the same time, I have a seven-year-old and a 4-year-old who are being raised the same way that I was raised. And I know that as they get older, they're going to ask questions about me. And they're going to be taught that I am a sinner and that I am an abomination.
That word will be used.
That word will be used. And this is the thing. I feel like one of the things I really want to do with them is I want to be present and I want them to know me as Aunt Shelley right now, because when they do hear that about me and when they do start to be taught that I am a sinner. That's fine, but I want them to know me first, right? Because it is harder to hate up close. And I want them to know me and to remember me the way that I am. So if they decide that I am an abomination, and if they choose to get on board with what they're being taught, that's fine. But they will know that I love them, right? And that I was good to them.
Like everything, like she finished her drug classes. She finished her parenting classes. And actually the night that she died, I had missed a call from her. I didn't answer her last phone call. But she had texted me also. Yeah. And she was filling out job applications because the only thing she had to do before we went back to court in February, which is when we got back to court, was have a job. And she would have gotten her kids back. Mm. She had been clean. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure she overdosed. I know my sister. But she had been clean and she was doing so well. She gained all her weight back. She was looking good. Like,
yeah.
Basically, my approach is I'm just very kind to everybody. I genuinely try to help everybody. If somebody asks me about my love life, I will tell them. If they don't ask, I just don't. It's not a conversation that we have, you know. And traditionally, especially because I was a counselor for a while, you know, with students, of course, you know, I run into gay students. And same, I didn't just, you know, lay that out there all the time. This is who I am, and this is my life. It was more of a, when I saw that I needed to, when I saw that I needed to talk about myself for the betterment of the student, I did. And when I saw that it wasn't really relevant, I just didn't. So yeah, it's just kind of a case-by-case basis. Know where you are. Know that it could cause you problems. Be prepared for that. But at the same time, at the end of the day, yes, I'm gay, but I'm also a lot of other things. And that's not my one defining factor, much like we were talking about with Casey. Yes, she was an addict.
But she was a person.
She was a person, and she was a lot of other things as well. So
she was a full human. Mm-hmm. In a heartbeat. Yeah.
People will be dancing and you'll see people running the aisles. You'll see people falling out in the spirit, which is literally like passing out in the floor, speaking in tongues, all of those things. And so June, and that still goes on, of course, but June was always kind of like the gauge for how charismatic the service was, because as a child, I remember her always, she always danced in the spirit, right? Which is very unlike her. She's quiet. She's not very comfortable being in the spotlight.
Very reserved.
Very reserved. But she would dance all over the church, and her hair was so heavy, she always wore it in a bun. And we would always say, well, June shouted her hair down, so you knew it was a good service. And she would dance so hard that her hair would fall down. And bobby pins would just be flying all over the church. And as a kid, that was my job. Like after church, I got to crawl under the pews and collect all of June's bobby pins and bring them to her. And I loved it because that was the only time. Any other time, crawling under pews would have gotten me in big trouble, right? The people that I went to church with here were very much family. And they still are, and they've always been wonderful to me. But they also, they believe that I am called to be an evangelist and a minister. And unless I'm doing that, they think I'm not doing God's will, right? And I'm not completing God's plan for my life. And they want me to do that because, again, what I was saying earlier is this all comes from a place of love. It's annoying and bothersome, but I know that it comes from a place of love because, much like I was saying about my parents, they genuinely believe that my eternal soul is in trouble. And I have a hard time being angry about that, you know, because that's their belief. And of course, I don't believe that, but they do, and it's a genuine concern.
We've definitely had disagreements about it, but I think in the past, what would you say, 2-3-ish years, I have been working on truly making my own peace with it. But no matter who you are, no matter where you are, it's hard, no matter what your identity is, whether it's a social identity, a sexual or gender identity, it's hard to be shunned, it's hard to be othered, it's hard to be excluded. And it's, it can be very painful. But, I think that she's worth it. I think Shelly's worth it. And I think that our relationship is worth it. And, we have our problems. We have our struggles just like anybody else does. It takes work. But, it can be very, very hurtful for sure. But I think that I have grown a lot in regard to my approach over the last 7 years. Because before I was like...
Yeah, I can see where if I were you, yeah. I would be mad. I think that would just be my first.
Furious.
Yeah, I think that would just be my first, initial knee-jerk kind of.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess you could even, think of it as, kind of grieving this idea of, the other family or the extended family or the in-laws or whatever. Yeah. I'll never have that. If we got married, it would be horrible. Right?
Yeah.
Not for us. But because of them, right?
And that's just something that, I've had to, which, like I said, I was married once before, to a man, and I did the whole traditional wedding thing. Spent a whole lot of money for a couple of hours, but at the same time, I know, I do want to marry Ashley, one day whenever we're ready. We're very slow, 7 years in, and we're still just maybe. But I do want to, but I do, I know that I have to be mentally prepared because my family will not be part of it. And it will be further upset. They're already, unhappy, but they will be more unhappy. Yeah.
Some more grief.
Yeah. But that's, that's okay. That's part of the process. And by that's okay. I mean, of course it's not, but that's not going to.
I think you're just at the point of acceptance.
Yeah. At the end of the day, my approach to that is always, when the day is done, my sister lays down with her husband. My mom lays down with my dad. They go to bed with the choices that they've made, and I don't mean go to bed as in their partners. I just mean we all lay down with the choices that we've made, whatever that choice is. And if I don't choose my truth, then if I live for them, I will be unhappy. And life is short. So at the end of the day, my grandmother always says, the truth will stand when the world's on fire. And it will, and it does. And at the end of the day, I'm going to choose my truth. Unfortunately, that upsets them, but, that it is what it is.
Can break down chair making into hundreds, maybe even thousands of different processes. And some of the processes fit this description more than others. But whenever there is a process that is extremely difficult, it takes thousands and thousands and thousands of hours. Repetition is the key to it. Repetition is the key. And that's what people aren't willing to spend. They'll spend the money, they'll buy the tools, they'll do everything possible. And they'll spend a little bit of time and they'll become okay. But unless you're willing and forced for income to come down to the shop every day and do that over and over and over again, and you get incrementally better and incrementally better, and this very difficult skill soon, where early on, there's a 50% failure rate. And what you're doing is you get it up to where there's a 5% failure rate or a 4% failure rate. Now, what happens is this. In order to pull that skill off, in order to pull that technique off, you've got to be, one, have all this repetition, but two, be totally immersed in it, and everything's got to be right. Nothing can be bothering you either externally or internally. You've got to build all cylinders have to be firing to pull it off. But even at that, your failure rate is there, even if it's 1%, and you always know that. If it was 50%, it would be too frustrating. So people don't do that. People don't do what has a 50% failure rate after practicing for 10,000 hours, okay? If there is no failure rate, they move on beyond that to something that has a failure rate automatically. You're pushed there. So what you want to hit with it is where, through practice and then through concentration, you can most likely pull it off. Most likely. That's the sweet spot. And that's where you want to be with your craft. And when you're there, what it feeds you and what it gives you because of this intense concentration that you've got to have is something that no drug or nothing else could possibly give you. And you can't get enough of it. So it forces you to keep coming back to it and back to it and back to it and back to it. And that's why you can make the same chairs over and over and over again, because there's that 1% chance or 2% chance of failure. Oh God, my relationships, love, hate. I'd leave it in a second and then I'd come back. I don't know. I mean, I can't leave. Got too many responsibilities here. I never thought I would live here, but I didn't think I'd live in the U.S., you know, and now I'm living 30 miles from where I was born. It's been good. You have to live somewhere.
Indeed.
And most places you would find are going to be the same and the people the same. There's a story about a fella who was looking at this town to move to, and he was wandering around town talking to people, and he asked this one guy, he goes, I'm thinking about moving here. He goes, how are the people? And the guy said, well, how were they where you were from? Where are you from? And he said, I don't like them. They're a bunch of assholes. And he said, that's what you'll find here. So that's, you know, that's the way it is. You've got to find a place and just say, okay, this one will do, and try to make it as good as you can.
No
the rest of
place.
Your life, work on it. Because if you're looking for that other place, you're going to be unfulfilled for the rest of your life. In the 70s, I was on the road a whole lot. Probably for 7 years, I was on the road for half of it. So I probably slept in my sleeping bag for however many days that is, half of 7 years hitchhiking. And, I loved it. And it's why I do what I do, because just that education was great and the people that I met. Mm-hmm. But one thing was never ending fun for me, and that was because I have the dumb accent. And I'm not smart, but I'm not dumb either. I'm very average as far as all that goes. But it was never ending the reaction to my accent and how it would play out. I always was waiting on it. And
Waiting for the
reaction.
Okay.
So that, I mean, it varied, and it wasn't always what you thought it might be, you know. Like a lot of people, because of your accent, thought you were the most honest, just down to earth person that ever met in their life. All it was your accent, you know. And I'd tell them that we had crooks down where we live too. we have people that do bad things here too. They talk exactly like I do. And but then other times you'd be categorized as really dumb. And when they, you know, heard you spell cat correctly, then you were automatically, oh boy, he's a lot smarter than I thought he was. So you could only go up from their expectations.
And so I guess that has its place.
That one was always funny too, you know. Yeah, you couldn't go down any further,
yeah.
You know. And then of course you're always expected to be a racist because of the accent, and so that was always an interesting one. There was one lady I was talking to one time, and she was older than me, and she starts tearing up. She's from California. She starts tearing up. She wasn't crying. She's tearing up. Finally, I stop, and I go, what? What is going on? And she goes, I just have to tell you, I am very biased against your accent, but what is coming out of your mouth does not match your accent, and it's messing with my emotions. Well, okay, that's a new one. I've never seen that reaction.
Do you remember what conversation you were having there?
Yeah, it was actually more recent, 1990s, it was past my hitchhiking days, and she wrote a book called The Chair, name's Galen Kranz, actually, and she teaches the sociology of how we interact with our living spaces at UC Berkeley, so, and Penland School of Arts got us together, me being a chair maker, and so we got together, and they said, tell her about your work in Central America. So I started a sustainable forestry project in Central America that I worked with for 10 years. I'd go down there and work with mostly indigenous peoples, and so I was telling her about that. So
what were you saying that surprised her, you think?
Oh, just the general story that I was involved in sustainable forestry and probably the words that I was using, you know, mm-hmm. and such. But yeah, so the accent continues to entertain people. I think that working with your hands and really working with your hands, where you've got your, where you are in depth in the material and the tools, and you're getting instant feedback from these tools as you're using it. I believe that is the ultimate in what, I don't know, how would you say it? It is, I don't believe you can spend your time any better for your mind and for your body. Now, cooking epitomizes that. You know, cooking to me is the ultimate craft. It combines it combines the tools, it combines science, it combines geography,
your senses,
history, yes, all your senses. And when you're cooking for others, your main ingredient is love. I mean, that's what you're doing. You want these people, you're cooking for these people to feed them. And then you've worked all day long at this, maybe for a few days, and it's over with in hours. And the evidence is all gone. Nothing's left of it. And that's just beautiful. I love that. I just love it. It's like combining, you know, chair making and music together, you know, it gets all of that together. So to me, that's the ultimate, is cooking. And And it's, I don't think it's viewed as that by most people. And I think we've gotten so far away from that, you know. I mean, you pick up the magazine, what's the magazine say? 5 meals in 5 minutes, you know. It's telling you, everything's telling you, you want to get this over with and out of the way. Out of the way for what? So you can watch more TV? What? Why? Why? Why do you need to get this out of the way for? You know, this is time worth spending. To me, the finished product has never been the chair. The finished product has been these little small increments of technique and execution. I nail that cut with a turning tool, and I know it, and it is as close to perfection as I can get, and it's like, wow, and it's over with. That's done. It's finished. If I die right there, my work's done. That chair is not left unfinished because it wasn't the finished product. The finished product was these little, small, tiny increments that you are so obsessed about. There's a bunch of stories about Mom, little vignettes, but one of my favorites is we were at the house one day and Mom's talking, and it's probably about 10 years ago, and she said, she's talking to Marilyn and I, but mostly to Marilyn, and she goes, oh, when Curtis was a little boy, we'd all get in the car ready to go to church, and he'd be in the back seat, and when we got settled in the car, getting ready to pull out, Curtis would always say, Mama, you look pretty this morning. And she looks at Marilyn, and she goes, he doesn't tell me that anymore. And Marilyn says, well, he tells me that. And Mom smiles real big, and she goes, he tells you that I'm pretty? That's my mom.
My name is Ida Maria Di Pinto Buchanan, and I was born on a beautiful Isle of Capri, which is 250 miles from Rome, 18 miles from the mainland Naples. And it is a beautiful, unforgettable island. Now, I met Johnny in 1946, and then I came over in America in 1947. So I've been here about 74 years. We'll be celebrating our wedding anniversary, 74 years this year. Right. Okay, John and I met in Capri. He was in the American infantry called the Blue Level, the Blue Devil. And he was in the northern part of Italy, and Capri was reserved for American Air Force or infantry American soldiers. I was working in a nice men's shop in Capri for a short time. And Americans set up activities for the American soldiers. And there was the American Red Cross with other places for the Americans to go and have a good time, coffee, ice cream, and everything. And my sister and I were at the Red Cross. We were allowed to go and talk to the soldiers. And so we start playing ping pong, my sister and I, and I was facing the entrance door of this building, and this handsome GI walks in, and with a friend who was a sergeant, and Johnny was a staff sergeant. They both looked handsomely beautiful in the American Air Force uniform. And so he came to the table, and he stood just watching us play, you know. He said, I played the winner. And we said, okay. So after we got through playing, then I played with John and I, John Buchanan. John and I, we played. he said, would you like to come? And I said, yes, I would like to come to America. On February the 10th, 1947, I got ready to make this trip. And I was packing for America. It was a big thing, you know.
Sure.
And so that day came. It was February the 10th. It was a little bad weather. And I boarded the ship at the Marine Falcon in Naples. And we were on water through the 20th of February. This was in February. And so I boarded the ship, and I was spoke very little English. So we got to Johnson City, and his sister, Judy, the youngest of the family, with her husband, came to meet us at the station when the train arrived. And so in the meantime, Johnny and Jerry went to pick up the car and bring it to closer to the, because it was cold and snow and bad in Johnson City. And his sister said, well, you are just as beautiful as Johnny described you. You don't have any makeup. You look so pretty, because she was loaded with makeup. And Johnny had told me that his sister used a lot of makeup or something. But anyway, we got in the car, and we were traveling up to the Arna Mountain. And now this time the road was bad. It wasn't as it is now. It was bumpy, bumpy, bumpy. And me and his sister sat in the back, and every little bit would say, Judy would say, Jade, be careful, Jade, be careful. I said, what's going on? She said, well, the snow and the ice, and we got to get home before it gets frost. Of course, I didn't understand any of this. All I knew, I was cold. So finally, we got to Bakersfield, which is it makes you think of Dodge City on TV, you know. Anyway, I had copper shoes, handmade blue suede sandals. I owned no boots. I didn't have no shoes to walk in the snow. So Johnny said, well, Jay, we better get either some boots. So we went to this little store that they were about to close that day about 5 o'clock. And the man said, John, I've got one pair of boots left. And these were the ugliest boots I've ever seen in my life. So they put those things on me, took my pretty shoes off. Now we turn around, and now we are headed for his home.
Were you scared?
Yes, I was, you know, the all way from Johnson City to the mountain was terrible. Every house we passed, is that your house? No. Is that your house? No. There were little houses, you know, said, and he said, when we get to my house, I'll let you know. There was a little bedroom that they fixed up for me. The boys stayed upstairs, and his mother and daddy in the other bedroom downstairs, and a furnace in the middle, which they didn't have the heating system that we have now. And so I went to bed, and so I hear the wind blowing, and the snow was coming through the window, the cracks in the window. And she told me, she said, now I put two sets of sheets on this bed. One is flannel and the other one is cotton. And if you get cold, you can get into the flannel. But I didn't pay any attention to that. I got up in the middle of the night, put my coat on, went in the living room and sat by the stove, the furnace, to keep warm. They were wonderful, wonderful farmers, but it wasn't my lifestyle.
Sure.
At all. But every day I said, well, I'm not happy. I'm not happy. I think so much about what kept me so together, what kept me so that I never thought about when going back to Capri. I never thought about being away from home so much. And I think it's a love that it's one of those things that you accept in your life, and this is the thing, it's for me, and I stayed with it. So now the mountains are not, it's a beautiful place for people that like that atmosphere, the what they do, dig potatoes, eat beans, and no activities, no social lives, and quite different than the Alakwe. So the first time I went back, I had 3 children at that time, so we went to Capri for 6 months. It was the doctor's order. You know, he said, I think you should go home. Part of having a lot of headaches, and the doctor didn't know how to take care of the situation. And they thought before they would get to a mental part that going home would be good. And that was the decision that I made to go home and stay. We stayed. Curtis was only 6 months old when we went. 6 months. Tommy was 5. Mary was 3. And they never saw 3 more beautiful children in their life. They kept talking about having a big time with them. And after spending 6 months, I was ready to come back. Ida, they got me Ida. But it's Ida. Ida. Because Italian is I-D-A. And in American, the I is an E. Ida. Ida. An American would pronounce I, Ida. But in Capri is Ida. I like the name Ida much better than Ida.
Did you feel like you lost a part of yourself when you moved here?
Yeah, I lost part of myself very much. I loved fashion. I loved beautiful things. My thing was beautiful things, beautiful clothes, beautiful things, and they weren't there. And I kept losing what I really was. I was born with the marble floor, crystal chandelier, and that kind. Not that we had that. We were just normal people. But the island is so, I mean, it holds you. The beauty, the experience, the fact of growing up. I went to parochial school. And it bothers me every day that I like that part of life better than, you know. I felt like that they knew their cows better than they did me. You know, it's such a transaction or difference in people. No, I felt very welcome, but there was not that, oh, how are you today? You know, Italian, oh, you look pretty today. Or none of that. You know, it was just, you know. It was just different, people different.
Over time, did you start to get parts of yourself back?
Yeah, over time. This was when Tommy was very a baby, barely walking. I think it was about that age. I said, I can't take much more of this, and we have to make a move. We gotta go somewhere. It was in 1948. You couldn't find a job. You couldn't find anything. And Johnny thought that he was gonna be a farmer the rest of his life, and I was gonna be a farmer. There was no way I could ever become one who went to the barn, get the bucket with the milk. I couldn't do that. I couldn't do anything that they were what they were. It was me, I was different. And so I just begged him and begged him, and finally, see what it was, he felt that he was one of the youngest with his youngest brother to take care of mother and daddy, and the wife would be there with them.
You.
In the house, me. But I took over, like cleaning and doing things the way they liked, but it wasn't what I liked. But I was taught to be kind and nice to everybody, and I never told them that I didn't like it there. I never did. I never expressed myself, and that was maybe a little bit of the problem, that I couldn't get myself to like it. It's just I can't even say it's a beautiful place, because it's not. It's very country, very, very, very country. They didn't even know what tomato paste was, what garlic was. And I wanted to cook, I wanted to have, and there was beans, cabbage, all that good Italian food. Mm-hmm. But it was up to me, either leave it or stay. And for me, wasn't easy. I was always proud of myself, of the fact that I accepted the life and,
that's what I did.
But he was able to have a good job, and we raised four kids, and everybody's doing well, and I've had the most of the 74 years old, I've had what I wanted. Mm. A good husband, a good man, but the one that I could have lost if I had left.
Dad was gone a lot.
Right.
And he drank quite a bit himself. He would go on these binges where he'd get really, really drunk.
What were the binges like?
Well, he'd just get so drunk where he couldn't get drunk, sick, couldn't get up. The doctor would have to come and give him glucose.
Mm. Would he put a drip in his arm?
Put a drip in his arm, yeah. He'd go for about 2 months, and then he'd go right back again.
So he was an alcoholic?
I don't think he was an alcoholic. He just got binges. He was a binge drinker.
Yeah. I feel like I think alcoholism can look different.
It's true.
Why do you think he drank the way he did?
He just liked it, I reckon. But mother would really get upset with him. He was talking about mom and dad.
Yeah.
She just didn't want to put up with it, so she put him out of the house. I told you that story where he came home drunk one night, beating on the door. Mother went to the door and said, she told him, said, "You're not coming in here like that." He said, "Open that damn door." He said, "Let me in." So she did. She opened the door, and she had a shoe in her hand, high heel shoe, and she hit him in the head with it, right there. And the house was built on the porch was built on stilts,
mm-hmm.
You know, these mining timber things.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had fell off the porch and crawled underneath the porch, and that's where we found him the next morning. But he had a scar right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Grandma Lulu wouldn't put up with it?
No.
Did he ever hit her?
I don't think so. If he did, I'm unaware.
Yeah.
No, he wasn't. He wasn't like that.
But you said that
after his binges, he would get kind of mean.
Yeah. He was mean.
Were you scared of him?
Yeah. Mm. Yep, very scared.
Dorothy too, or just you? Was it you or Dorothy too?
I think it's just me.
Why do you think he was so mean to you?
He wasn't mean to me, he just scared me. Yeah. He never really had to whip me. Mm-hmm. Never.
Just looked at you.
He scared me.
What was your relationship like with him?
Well, it was pretty good.
Yeah.
For that situation.
Did he ever tell you that he loved you?
Not to my knowledge.
Really?
I don't remember him ever telling me that, no. Mm-hmm. And I was born in a three-room house, no running water. And they said I had a cord around my neck. And
your umbilical cord?
Umbilical cord. And what they call midwives? Came up and took care of mother and picked me up, shook me, and started breathing.
Wow.
So that's where it all started. This was in a little place called Sookie Ridge. It was just outside of Harlan.
Okay. What year was it when you were born?
1945. Fourth month, 18th day, 45. Yeah.
And how many siblings did you have?
There were five of us in the family. I had a brother that was born dead, mother's first child.
Oh yeah, and what did the doctor tell her?
The doctor told her to never have any more children, and she had five. So, yeah.
What was your mom's name?
Lula. Dad's name was Don. Brother was Bobby. Oldest sister was Joanne. And then June, and then Dorothy, who's younger than me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you were second oldest?
Third.
Third?
Yes.
So what are some memories of just growing up, starting from, you know, as early as you can remember? Doesn't have to be anywhere in particular, just...
Yeah. I was playing basketball at Harlan. And we were supposed to have a game that night on a Friday night, Friday the 13th, January the 13th.
How old were you?
15. Mm-hmm. And so I walked down to the cab lot where he was, and he had kind of changed a little bit where he wanted to come home and stay home. You know, he'd come in real late at night. But anyway, he kind of changed. So I went back. His car was parked at the back of the cab lot. So I went back and got in the car. He came out. I said, "Get in. I'm going to drive." He said, "All right, well, I'll see if you can drive." So I drove home. We ate supper. He laid down on the couch, took a nap, and I went. Since we didn't have a game, I was going to go to a movie. Mm-hmm. So he took me back to town. I went to this movie, and one of my real good friends, I was sitting there by myself, walked in and tapped me on the shoulder and said, "You got to go." I said, "What is it?" "I knew something bad had happened." He said, "Your dad's been shot." So I walked up, they took me out to the hospital, and he died at the hospital. And so that was a shock.
Did you get to talk to him?
No.
Did you see him before he died?
No. Hmm. Nope.
How did you react?
Angry.
Do you remember, like, the room? Were you in the hospital when...
Just in the lobby.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was angry. Yeah.
Was anyone there with you?
Yeah, my friends. All the boys, all the guy that came in and got me and two or three other my friends. They were the ones that took me out to the hospital.
So you were the first one there out of all your family?
Yes. But anyway, he died.
Can you tell the story of like why he ended up dying the way he did?
Are you comfortable talking about it?
Yeah, only if you're comfortable.
Well, the guy shot him 9 times. Daddy had supposedly changed a $20 bill for him or something. And then he turned on her, started ranting and raving, and Dad said, you can't be doing that in here. So he got pissed off and said, I'll be back. So he left and went down the street somewhere and got a pistol. Came up the street. Daddy stepped out in the cab lot there. I don't know if he was ever there. You've seen it.
We drove by one time.
Yeah.
We walked past it.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When we went to, I think when we ate that pizza place with Jim and Daryl and we walked past.
But the guy shot him, started shooting and started running, and Dad was able to shoot him. He killed him.
So they killed each other?
Yeah. So that Harlan County lore.
How did Grandma Lula react to all that?
Well, she was tore up about it, obviously.
Yeah, it was so sudden, you know?
Yeah.
Surprising to me that you are as
grounded
and as giving and kind and certainly not abusive.
Well, I didn't want to be like him.
Did you know that? Like, did you have a gut feeling when you were younger? Did you know that? Or was it only after
I did.
You moved out?
I loved him, but I didn't want to be like him. No.
Did Dorothy, Aunt Dorothy and Bobby, how did they feel about him?
I think Bobby felt about the same. Mm-hmm. But Dorothy, she was so young, she just didn't, she hadn't really
developed.
Synthesized all that stuff, yeah.
Have a conversation with Grandma Lula right now, what would you say to her?
Tell her I loved her.
Yeah, I know.
One thing that stuck with me all my life was, is that Mom had mentioned it a while ago, was is that there was a drugstore in Harlan. Mm-hmm. And it had a sign up there. And he said, live and let live. Mm-hmm. And that stuck with me all my life. So, you know, I'm not going to judge anybody else, and I don't want them judging me. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There you go.
There you go.